Hi guys, it is an exciting Saturday night. Saturday night, November 5th, 2023, and I am sitting here on an exciting Saturday night in my new trailer. I have no internet, and so if in case you missed the introduction, what I am doing is I have stumbled upon a manuscript, a children's story I wrote in 1980 when I was 21 years old. I have not read this book myself, probably, since I wrote it 43 years ago. So this is almost as new to me as you. So just so you can get a peek into the children's book author sitting inside of your old Doomer, we bring you Maurice and the Rainbow Maker. This is 7 chapters. So I am going to make 7 videos, and we're going to dive right in to Maurice and the Rainbow Maker. Copyright 1980 by Hambone Littletail. Chapter 1, Maurice's First Rainbow. Maurice, a little mole in the ground, knew there had to be more to life than chasing worms, digging tunnels, and banging his head on tree roots all day. The little mole had never once seen the sunshine, nor had he ever picked a daisy, sniffed a rose, heard a bluebird sing, felt a raindrop, or tasted a banana ice cream cone. He'd never even heard of ice cream. He decided one dark day, a mole in the ground knows nothing but dark days, to pack up and leave. He went to tell his mother goodbye. "Mama," said Maurice, "I have decided there's got to be more to life than chasing worms, digging tunnels, and bumping my head on tree roots all day." "Mo, you're a mole," she said, as if Maurice had never noticed he was a mole. "And moles are supposed to chase worms and dig tunnels." "Who says?" asked Mo, who had never heard it said. What moles were supposed to do or not do? "Nobody has to say what a mole is supposed to do," his mother said. "Moles have always chased worms and dug tunnels. Your grandfather dug a tunnel 2 miles long, in fact." "And what did he have when he finished?" asked Mo. "He had a 2-mile tunnel. What do you think he had?" replied his mother. "Mo, you can be the silliest little mole sometime. What started you talking about this anyway?" "Mama, I'm going up above," Mo said flatly. There was silence in the mole hill while Maurice's mother prepped the speech Mo knew was coming. "Mo, this silly talk has gone far enough. Your Uncle Harry went up above, and he was never heard from again. There's no telling what awful thing happened to him." She shook her gray-haired head. Mo had heard the tale of poor Uncle Harry 1,000 times. "But Mama," he said, "if nobody ever saw Uncle Harry again, how do you know anything bad happened to him? Couldn't it be that what he found up above was better than what he left down below?" "Enough of this," shrieked Mo's mother, who had had enough of that. "Of course something bad happened to your Uncle Harry. Something terrible. There's all kinds of terrible things up above. Monsters. Dragons even." She stamped her little pink foot against the dirt floor, and a small dirt clod fell from the ceiling and landed in the middle of the dinner table. "Now look what's happened," squawked Mo's mother. "Mo, you get out of here and go catch 3 beetles, a centipede, and a basket of roly-polies. Your father will be home soon, and he'll want something to munch on. And get that silly notion of going up above out of your furry little head." "Yes, Mama," mumbled Mo. He headed for the door of the molehill. Outside in the tunnel, it was dark, cool, and damp, the way it had been every day of Mo's life. That was because there was no weather under the ground. The sun never shone, the rain never fell, and the wind never blew. Mo soon had his basket half full of fat roly-polies. Roly-polies were easy. All Mo had to do was yell boo at a bunch of roly-polies, and they'd all roll up into little balls. Then he just picked them up and popped them into his basket. The centipedes were harder. For that, Maurice had to sprinkle foot powder on the floor of the tunnel and wait. It took 20 minutes for a centipede to smell the powder. When the centipede started rubbing powder onto its 100 tired feet, Mo pounced and threw it into the basket with the roly-polies. The roly-polies, who had been scurrying around the basket, rolled themselves into little balls again. It was almost an hour before Mo saw his first beetle. It was a beauty with shiny black wings and a plump orange belly. The beetle saw Mo and started digging to escape, and Maurice started digging after it. The beetle dug hard, but Maurice dug harder. Mo was inches from catching the juicy beetle when bong! He smashed his nose into a tree root. "Ouch!" cried Mo, tenderly rubbing his soft pink nose, which had a big purple bruise forming in the middle of it. Mo hated tree roots. He was running into them all the time. 15 minutes later, Mo saw another beetle. The beetle saw Mo at the same time and started digging. But instead of digging down, the beetle started digging straight up. It may have heard that moles were supposed to live in the ground and never go up above. Mo was right behind the beetle and gaining on it fast when something happened that made Mo stop as quick as if he had smashed into another tree root. Indeed, Mo had run into another root, but it was not a big tree root. It was simply a grass root. Something even a little mole like Mo could break between his fingers. But you see, to a mole in the ground, a grass root had always been the number one sign of danger. Dun-dun! To a mole in the ground, a grass root is more than a stop sign. To a mole in the ground, a grass root is more than a red light. To a mole in the ground, a grass root is more than a railroad gate with flashing lights and clanging bells. To a mole in the ground. A grass root is the root of all evil. For where there are grass roots, there is grass only inches away. And where there is grass, there has to be sunshine and rain and monsters and fire breathing, Uncle Harry eating dragons. Yes. What do you think, little log? Grass grows up above, thought Maurice. A shudder creeping up his back. Dun-dun-dun! Up above, where moles, which are 50 times bigger than beetles, are not supposed to go because it is too dangerous. And moles, as everyone knew, were supposed to hide in the ground, chase worms, and dig tunnels all day. Maurice was thrilled, scared, and nervous all at the same time. He'd always wanted to go up above, but at the same time, he was scared to go. He knew he was bored down below, but he also knew that he knew nothing about up above. For the thousandth time in his life, Mo turned around and headed back down. But then he stopped. Just one peek, and I will never have to wonder again, he said to himself. Ever so slowly, he continued up with each snapping root. Mo's nose was greeted with the sweetest aroma of freshly mown hay. After years of smelling nothing but dirt and worms, the delicious new smells made Maurice tremble with excitement. As Mo's tiny pink hands and nose continued upward, the dirt became much looser, wetter, and easier to dig in. Then suddenly, there was no more dirt. For the first time in his life, Mo's nose broke through to up above. What do you think, little dog? Mo's nose broke through to up above like that. Cautiously, Maurice sniffed the strange air. His head was filled with what seemed like a million new aromas. Eager to find out more about the exciting new aromas, Mo took a long, deep breath. Suddenly, Mo's nose was flooded with water. The water filled his tiny nose and ran into his mouth. Mo fell back into his mole hole, coughing, sputtering, and wheezing as if he were about to drown. It took a full 5 minutes for Mo to catch his breath. Even then, his heart still raced. He picked up his basket of roly-polies and started back down. But again, he stopped. Wait a minute, he said to the roly-polies, who had no choice but to wait. I never did get my first peek of up above, and though I don't know what just happened, I do know that I'm okay now. And in fact, I have learned my first lesson about up above. Sniff things out carefully before you plunge headlong into them. Yes. Once again, Maurice started up, being careful to keep his nose almost shut. He stopped at the mouth of the hole, and gathering all his courage, he rammed his furry little head into the open air. His beady black eyes were half blinded by a blur of gray and green as they tried to get used to this first real light Mo had ever seen. This time, a giant splash of water plopped right between Mo's ears. The raindrop. Mo didn't know it was a raindrop because he'd never seen one before. Soaked through his thick gray fur on his head and tickled his skin. It felt great. Mo giggled and wiggled out of the hole to take his very first bath. You can bet he needed one too, as he had spent his whole life living in dirt. The wet grass tickled his furry belly, and Mo ran laughing in circles in the rain. Little rivers of mud flowed from his fur. As much fun as he was having, Maurice soon grew cold, and he looked for a place to get out of the rain. He happened upon a tall toadstool with white warts all over it, and made a pleasant shelter. Mo leaned against what looked like a smaller, warty toadstool under the big toadstool so he could watch the rain. "Excuse me," croaked a deep voice from behind Mo. The startled mole jumped up and banged his head on the roof of the mushroom. It was soft, nothing like a tree stump.
"I didn't mean to scare you," said the voice,
which seemed to be coming from the smaller toadstool.
"But I do think there's enough room for both of us to escape the rain without us having to sit on one another."
"I'm terribly sorry," said Mo, still thinking the toadstool was talking.
"I am Toad, Thelonious J. Toad," said the voice.
It was only when Thelonious J. Toad offered Mo his hand that Mo saw the toad. Maurice hoped the toad did not realize that Mo had made him out to be a talking toadstool. They shook hands, and Thelonious J. Toad listened politely while Mo told his story. "Don't you ever get bored just sitting here under this toadstool watching the rain your whole life?" Mo asked Thelonious J. Toad. The excitement of up above was wearing off already.
"I don't just sit here under this toadstool my whole life watching the rain," said the toad. "In fact, I usually sit on top of this mushroom. After all, it is a toadstool."
"But don't you get cold sitting out in the rain?" asked Mo.
"My friend, it's not raining all the time," explained the toad.
"It isn't?" asked the surprised mole, who came from a place where the weather never changed.
"Why, no," laughed Thelonious J. Toad. "In fact, it's just about stopped raining now. This is mostly just water dripping off the roof of the toadstool."
"You're right," laughed Mo, hardly believing his eyes.
"Would you like to join me for a cup of tea on top of my toadstool?" invited Thelonious J. Toad.
The mole nodded, and the toad helped him up the slippery toadstool. As as they drank, Thelonious pointed out the many different flowers, trees, rocks, butterflies, and birds. While Thelonious was explaining the tadpole to toad life story, the sun broke out from behind the clouds, and the land was bathed in brilliant warm sunshine. Mo covered his eyes with his hands. "What's that?" he asked in alarm. "That's the sun," explained Thelonious J. Toad.
"Well, I don't like it. It hurts my eyes," complained Mo, who had lived his whole life in darkness.
"My friend, without the sun, there would be no grass, no summer, no beautiful sunsets, and no Sunday dinners," explained the toad.
"Although it sometimes gets in our eyes, you must admit that it feels good on your back."
It did at that. There was nothing like a sun bath where Mo came from. He lay back for a few minutes, letting the warm sunshine beat upon his belly. He remembered it was getting late.
"I really must be going," said Maurice. "Thank you so much for the tea and use of your toadstool."
"Any time," said Thelonious J. Toad. Maurice slid down the slippery stem of the toadstool and started back toward his mole hole. When he got to his hole, he glanced up to take one last look at up above. His eyes were filled with the loveliest sight he had ever seen. A rainbow stretched across the sky above Mo, its bright streaks of red, orange, yellow, blue, green, and violet, kissing him farewell. For several minutes, Mo stood and stared at the sight. He knew then and there that he would be back sometime, just because he was born a mole in the ground. Did not mean he always had to be a mole in the ground. Somehow, the rainbow told him that. Mo was turning to climb back into his mole hole when something bonked him on the head. Bonk! He looked down, and there, in the grass, was what looked like a small pebble. He picked small pebble, it glowed all the colors of the rainbow. Mo picked it up. "Oh my goodness," said Mo to himself, "this must have fallen out of the rainbow. I know that the rainbow maker will be terribly upset if he were to lose this, but how do I find him to give it back?" He followed the rainbow with his eyes to where it disappeared behind the mountains far to the west. As he stood figuring out how to find the rainbow maker, the rainbow faded, then disappeared.
"Oh no," thought Mo. "Now I've got to find the rainbow maker and give him back this piece of the rainbow." And with that thought in his mind and the piece of rainbow in his hand, Maurice headed westward to find the rainbow maker. And that brings us to the end of chapter one. Just so you know, I'm not making it up. We will come back with chapter two, High Hopes. High Hopes. Coming right up. I'm not making this up. Well, I made it up. You know what I'm saying. Right back at you with
high herbs. Bye, guys.